Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Okay, so day before yesterday, what are the things we have discussed is, let's have a recap on a very high level, what are the topics we have covered. Okay, so the first one is, how to design. Have to design our cluster and how big it should be, right? Based on the incoming data, we will be planning our cluster size, and we had seen an example for that as well. And the second one is, right, these are the high level things we have discussed, right? How we have to design few admin commands, what type of operating systems we can use to install Hadoop, and how to add a new node or delete a new node. What are the things that we have to keep in mind while adding a new node, because we have to do some cluster balancing and few commands are there to balance this cluster as well, right? So let's talk about what are the types of modes that we can install Hadoop today, okay, and also a few important configuration sites. So once you get to know about these configuration sites, tomorrow we can discuss on the actual installation process. Okay, so this is the first one. Hadoop can be installed and run in three different ways. Okay, there are different ways to install Hadoop and use it, because it can be used for a single machine or number of machines as well, right? So we have different modes of installation to run it on different number of machines. So the first one is local job runner mode. So we will discuss about that in the next slide, okay? And the second one is pseudo distributed mode. And the last one, which is a very important one and which is used in most of the companies, is distributed mode. So that is how the beauty of Hadoop comes with, right? Distribution is the main important thing. Let's see the first one, which is local job runner mode. What it says is, runs on the local file system and not on HDFS. So earlier when Hadoop was installed, they doesn't have a storage for themselves. In a sense, they use it to use the local file system of that operating system itself, so that they doesn't maintain any database, something different for Hadoop. So it is like our MapReduce program use it to run as a simple common Java program. Just they use it to follow the structure or strategy to run a MapReduce program. But it looks like a common Java program, but it doesn't actually follow the distribution of the data or accessing the data from different locations. So it's like a regular Java program. So that's what it's saying. No Hadoop processes are required to run. So actually we have different processes, right? In the sense, different daemons that would be running whenever we install Hadoop and start running any program. So in local job runner mode, no Hadoop process. Everything use it to run in a single one JVM. That's what it is saying again. Everything runs on a single JVM. So if at all, if you go in login into your Hadoop systems and it's being installed in local job runner mode, you cannot see all the services running like name node, secondary name node, job tracker, data node and task tracker. So for example, if one goes down, everything will goes down, because everything is interdependent. ideal for MapReduce program is during development phase, because it doesn't need to fetch any particular information from different areas. So that is where, just to test our MapReduce program, which is designed in the way Hadoop programs need to be, it will be good only for that purpose, but it will not give you the actual purpose of Hadoop, like getting the data from different areas or processing in multi-threaded way. Does run with certain limitations, like only one reducer can specify it. So don't worry about this. I will let you know like what is a reducer and what the function of it, how many reducers we can use, and what is the reason of having multiple reducers and all those things. But as of now, remember, like in local job runner mode, we will be able to use only one reducer in our MapReduce programs. Okay. The next one is pseudo distributed mode. So this is the important, one of the important modes that we would be discussing about, and even tomorrow we will be installing Hadoop in pseudo distributed mode. Okay, the most that is currently used by us, not only by us, even if you go to companies and have a look, they would be using a pseudo distributed mode for their test environments and all those things, or developer environments. Only in production they used to have some other mode, but for their development environments and the areas where they use it to write MapReduce programs is on pseudo distributed mode only. So what it happens exactly here is, each daemon like name node, data node, etc. runs in its own JVM. Basically each daemon runs independently. See, let's see what is a JVM. We all know, I think, hopefully we all know like what is a JVM. It's like a Java virtual machine. So every process will run under a Java virtual machines. In the sense, all were not interrelated. So everything is independent. So for example, if one process goes down, there is no rule or nothing set up like another process also needs to go down. So this is where we are going to install through our VM. Simulates the real Hadoop cluster on a single physical machine. Because as we are going to install Hadoop on a single physical machine, we need to run everything on its own. In the sense, all the processes need to be run on its own. So that's the reason we are using pseudo distributed mode. Uses HDFS for storing the data. So here we will be retrieving the data, or we will be loading the data into our HDFS from our local file system, and then we will be using these paths in our MapReduce programs. Perfect for developing and testing apps before launching into cluster. So before actually loading into our distributed mode or our multi-node clusters, whatever the programs we are deploying, we use it to first develop in this mode, test if everything goes well and running well in this mode, and then only we will deploy in our production environments in a different distributed mode. Okay. So the last one is distributed mode, the mode for which Hadoop was really made. So no clashes or nothing, no dependency on each of things, everything runs on its own JVM and multiple threads can be executed at the same time. So completely distributed. In the real world Hadoop clusters, data node and task trackers run on a single mode, and all the remaining processes will run on independent modes, in the sense independent machines. In real world Hadoop clusters, name node, secondary name node and job trackers run on dedicated machines. So if you take a distributed mode, this is how the cluster looks like. So this is how the machines look like in distributed mode. So whatever we had discussed in our first classes of HDFS is of distributed mode only. If you take pseudo mode, everything, all the process will run on a single machine. So machine 1 will contain name node, secondary name node, job tracker, task tracker and data node. So all the 5 processes will run on a single machine. But you will be able to see that all these 5 processes are running and everything is independent to each other. But if you take a local machine, in the sense local mode, you will not be able to see that all these processes are running or not. And if one particular process goes down, everything will go down. Okay. So let's come to few configuration sites. In a Hadoop cluster, complete Hadoop package is typically installed on each machine. So if you take a distributed mode where we have set of machines, suppose again if we consider the same thing, here we have 100 machines. So what we will do in distributed mode is we will install Hadoop on each of the machine. So on 100 machines we will be installing Hadoop in a pseudo distributed mode or somewhere, so such that both all the 100 machines will act together and they will work as a distributed mode. Each node has its own set of configuration parameters. Suppose think like there were some 10 to 20 configurations that needs to be done on each of the Hadoop installation. So each machine will have its own set of configuration. So this machine may have configurations as confun. I'm just mentioning the name as confun. There is nothing like confun. I'm just trying to let you know like the configurations would be different. Most of the times it would be same, but maybe sometimes for name nodes and secondary name nodes and job trackers, the configurations might be different and the configurations would be same for all the remaining machines. So that is how it happens. Etc. So it looks in this way. Most configurations are similar across the cluster. So all the data nodes will generally follow the same configuration. The name node might have a slight different configuration or an extra configuration that would be set up for name node. All the important configuration files are present in Hadoop configuration directories. So there is a particular directory which will be created by default when we install Hadoop, and all the configurations will go and sit into that directory. Typically, configuration files are present in configuration directory. So the directory name would be conf. So once you install Hadoop, you can go and see into this directory like what are the different files that were available and what is the setting that we have. But it's not much important for a developer point of view, but if you are trying to become an admin or something, you can deep dive into these things as well. So most important configuration files are that you will ever play with or core-site.xml, that is the first configuration file, and the second one is hdfs-site.xml, and the last one is mapred-site.xml. So all the configurations will generally be written in XML files only. So XML files means they will follow a particular format or they will follow a particular script. So we have to write all these configurations if at all in a tagline, if at all I want to include any new configurations, because by default you will have something, but if I want to give some new configuration, then I need to write it in XML format only. So let's see what it contains. The first one is core-site.xml. So as the name indicates, all the core configurations will be available in this particular XML. So for example, I want to keep or change something related to my master node IP address. For example, there is a particular IP address that we are connecting for the master node. Now I want to change that IP address to some address which I want to connect. So the master node is common for everything, right? HDFS will talk with master nodes, MapReduce would have a communication with master nodes. So the master node is like a common thing for our Hadoop configuration itself. So that's the reason it's placed in core-site.xml. So again, if you take the HDFS-site.xml, it is completely particular about HDFS configurations only. So whatever the configurations I want to give regarding HDFS, maybe the block size. As we all know, the default block size is 64 MB, right? Now I want to change that block size. So what is the site that I would be looking for is hdfs-site.xml, because it is a site which will maintain all the configurations related to HDFS. Maybe the replication factor or few other things where HDFS will be taking care of, right? So all those type of information we will be seeing in hdfssite.xml. The last one is mapred.site.xml. So you should be answering it now, like what I will contain in my mapred.site.xml. Just by looking the name, you can tell me. Guys, come on, say something. Right. So all the MapReduce related things will be given in this MapReduce.xml. So suppose I want to change the IP address of my job tracker. So definitely job trackers and task trackers will be related, or they are connected to MapReduce configurations only. So I will have those configurations in my MapReduce.xml. So these are the three main XMLs that we will be discussing on. There are few other things also, but tomorrow I will be explaining them while I explain you the installation modes. I mean in the installation process. So this is how you would see, like, as I told you, everything will be in XML format, right? If you see or compare the core site.xml and HDFS site.xml, this is how it would look like. So the first one is the version number which you are using right now, and the next one is just the name of that particular site, and then every property will be included in two tags called as configuration and property. So whatever you want to declare, you have to declare inside a configuration tag, and then a property tag should be given. So if you see here, a sample HDFS site.xml is given where I am giving the replication factor. I am trying to declare my replication factors here. So by default it would be 3, but if at all I want to change my replication factor to 1, this is how I have to give in my HDFS site.xml. So the replication name will be written as name, dfs.replication, and the name. The value would be, now I am declaring as 1 because I am writing it in a, I am going to install it in a pseudo distributed mode, right? So I don't need to maintain any replications, or I don't want it exactly how the typical distributed Hadoop cluster look like, right? So this is why I use it to follow the replication factor as 1 only. So if at all admin guy or any other guy, maybe from a developer point of view, there is something given or something declared by admin, I myself can go and change this hdfsite.xml, right? For example, if admin thinks like no one wants to have a permission on this particular site, on this particular property, he can give it as final. So under the configuration, property, name, value, I will give it as a final again. Property, name. So, and also guys, remember, every tag will end with a end tag in this way, so it will have a backslash such that it indicates that it's the end of that particular property. So this is how it looks like. For example, if the admin guy gives this replication factor in this way, then there is no way that the developer can change this particular setting. He has to follow the replication factor as 1 only. There is no other option to edit this file. So the command would be final as true. If it is false, means the developer or any guy can change this particular configuration on his machine. So, and the core site is the same thing which we had followed in HDFS site. Again, the name and value would change. So fs.default.name. So this will tell you like what is the name node address that we are going to connect. So the default address would be 8020 port. So the name node would be connecting to a port called as 8020. So every machine, I mean every type of setups will have their own port numbers, right? So for example, if you take maybe Apache or something, it would connect to 80 port. Or else if you take Tomcat, it will connect to 8080 ports. So those are default ports, and again it is configurable. We can give whatever the port we want, so such that this particular process will connect to that port. So defining HDFS details in HDFS site. So these are few important properties that we would be declaring in HDFS site. Not that everything is mandatory, but a few things we would be giving. So the first one we will see is dfs.data.dir. So the value is I am giving. So as I told you, in a cluster, in a typical cluster, I would be copying the name nodes or master nodes into different disks, right? So in order to maintain a rated property, I will be copying those values to two or three different directories. Here he is copying the values to disk 1 HDFS data, and again the same value is copied to disk 2 HDFS data. So we are manually creating the replication for these type of values, right? So this is what the description: a list of directories where the data nodes store blocks. Each block is stored in only one of these directories, but if I want to store it in different places also, it is possible. fs.checkpoint.directory. So it will give you a list of directories where the secondary name node stores the checkpoints. So every time, every intervals, particular intervals, I need to copy fs image and edit blocks from my name node to my secondary name node, right? So this is where the location it actually stores the values. So if you see the mapred.site.xml, this is how it look like. So the job tracker is going to connect to the port 8021 by default, and it is how it looks like, mapred.job.tracker as a name. So a few of the important properties again of a mapred.job.tracker is the port value whatever we are going to connect, and next one is mapred.local.directory. So it will let you know like a list of directories where MapReduce store intermediate data of jobs. So what happens in a typical MapReduce program is whenever a mapper is executed, the data or the outputs that were generated by the map job will be stored in a local in a local database, but not on HDFS. So the all the intermediate data is not used by us, right? We don't need the all intermediate data. Where the customer looks like is the final output data. So that's the reason we will store all the intermediate data in our local file system, and this is the directory where we will declare like where it should store in my local systems. And the next one is mapred.system.directory, the directory related to fs.default.name where shared files are stored during a job run. So generally so many shared files will be there which were used by different data nodes, right? So those type of shared files will be declared in this particular property. And the next one is maybe an important thing which we can talk about is mapred.tasktracker.maptasks.maximum. It will let you know like the number of map tasks that may be run on a task tracker at a single point of time. So for example, I am running a MapReduce program. It can be running parallelly in different data nodes at the same time. So this property will let you know like how many map tasks are running on my task tracker at a single point of time. Maybe I'm in my data node, I'm running 4 to 5 tasks at a single point of time. So this will let you know like how many tasks I can run on my single data node machine. So the default value I had given is 2, in the sense two tasks can run simultaneously at a single point of time. In the sense, map tasks. Okay. The next one is reduce tasks. Again, the same thing. How many reduces that can run on my single machine? The default value is 2. One second, guys. Are you able to hear me now? Okay, fine. So these are the most configuration numbers. So HDFS can interact in many ways. One of the way is through web access. So if at all I want to see how my name node daemon is running, I can connect to this particular site. HTTP localhost 50070. So this is the default port, and in whatever way I install my Hadoop. Okay, fine. In whatever way I install Hadoop, I have to connect to this site only to see how my name node is running or whether my name node is up or not also. So for job tracker it would be 50030. And for task tracker, it would be 50060. I will connect and I will show you these things today, okay? So don't worry about this. So whatever the properties that we had seen till now for each of the site is very minimal. There will be hundreds of properties that can be declared in each of the sites. So these are the default links that will show you like how many properties are there and how many types of configurations we can give as per our wish. So maybe you can connect to any one of these and you can see also. Let me show you one single thing. See, these are the number of properties I have only for my core site.xml. So let me go down. So whatever we had discussed is maybe fs checkpoint directory which we had discussed. What else we had seen? Maybe we will see this hadoop.temp.directory where our temporary files are stored. Most of the times wherever you install Hadoop, you might be seeing this one also. But all these are like only related to admin concepts and they are bothered about this. None of the developer is bothered about these things. Okay, again, this is the one fs.default.name. Most of the times we will come across this also. So that's what I see. So you can very well connect to these and check like what are the configurations you have, okay? And there is one more important configuration file called as hadoop environment.sh. So before installing Hadoop, we would be installing Java into our Hadoop machine, into my local machine. So where my Java is located and all those paths I would be giving in my hadoop environment.sh file. So if I open this file, you will be seeing like where my Java version, what is the version of my Java and where it is located actually. So again, it would be stored in the configuration directory itself. So it's very good enough that you go to configuration site once you install Hadoop and have a high level look on it. That would be enough basically. And one of the property I can give in hadoop environment.sh is heap size. So any idea of heap size? What is that? Anyone can tell me? Anyone can give a try on this heap size? It's not particular to Hadoop, so that's the reason I was asking you. Exactly, Krishna. Right. So in Java, what we will do is, we will allocate some temporary memory to store all local data or values or intermediate data that was generated. So all the type of temporary memory will be stored based on the heap size that we are giving in a particular area. So here I am giving like export Hadoop underscore data node heap size is equal to 128. So what I am telling is, whatever the temporary data that is being generated by my data nodes, they can use up to 128 MB or whatever the information I am going to you. If at all I am talking about task tracker, it can go up to 512. So this is how the heap size I can declare. So whenever you connect to name node web interface or something, it will show you that how much percentage of heap size is used and still how much percentage of heap size is left or something like those informations it will show you. So this is how the typical environment.sh file looks like. So if you see the highlighted one, it will show you the home Java home path where I had installed my Java before installing Hadoop. So the next thing is formats and precedence. Same configuration can be specified multiple times. The one with highest precedence takes the priority. So suppose in a cluster I have 100 machines, and as I told you, on each of the machine I will be declaring the configurations. Okay, so there will be some precedence on pulling these configurations. The precedence from lowest to highest is site.xml on slave nodes. So this takes the lowest priority. So maybe my data node have some configuration in my site.xml. That will take my lowest priority. And the second priority goes to site.xml on client machine. So there will be a client machine that would be connected to my Hadoop cluster, right? So my client machine takes much more priority than my slave node. So in my cluster, the admin guy has declared as replication factor as 1. So but while as a client I am going to Hadoop, I am going and connecting to Hadoop cluster, I can give the replication factor as 3, such that I will have my machine or my data gets replicated thrice. And the highest precedence will take through my MapReduce jobs. So whatever I declare in my MapReduce program, that will take my highest priority. So suppose even my MapReduce program, I will go and declare as number of reducers should be 3. So even though whatever the value I have in my MapReduce site.xml, this value will get overrided in my MapReduce site.xml for that particular program. So this is how the precedence goes. It's okay. The remaining things we can discuss tomorrow, but for today I will just show you like the web interfaces and all those things. So don't worry guys, tomorrow I will explain you like how to connect and how to start up your services and all. So for now, just have a look on how the web interface looks like. So just let me explain you this particular concept. So JPS is a command which will show you how many processes were running in my Hadoop environment. So if you see here, there are 5 demons that were running or 5 processes that were running at the backend, right? So the first one is the data node, Second is a name node. And JPS, it's just a service. It's showing like JPS through JPS command. You are able to see all those things. So you don't need to worry about that JPS. And the third one is job tracker. Fourth one is secondary name node. And the fifth one is task tracker. So after tomorrow, when you are trying to install Hadoop on your system, you should be able to see that all these five processes are up and running. Then only you can say that your Hadoop installation is perfect and it is up to go further. Okay, so I will show you how the web interface looks like. So the default port is 50070 for checking the name node, right? I had shown you in the PPT. So this is the site I am going to connect and check my name node status. So this is how it's showing. The name node is connected to localhost 54310, where this port I had given in my which site.xml? Can anyone tell me? Can anyone give a try on this? Right, Krishna. Right. You will be declaring this in your core site.xml. So if you see the cluster summary here, it is telling you like these number of files are there and these number of blocks were there in total, and this is the heap size. I told you like how much percentage of heap size is used, how much is remaining and all those things. So this is what it is showing, how much DFS percentage is used, what is the still remaining percentage, and live nodes. So as I am installing Hadoop in my pseudo distributed mode, I have only one node, right, where all the processes were running only on single node. In the sense, the name node is running on the same node and the data node is also running on the same node. So that's the reason I am seeing live nodes as one. For example, if I go for a distributed environment and see, I would see like number of nodes as 5 to 6 machines. For example, if my cluster is 100 size, I would see like live nodes as 100. And if at all, if any node is not working or something, it will show you in dead nodes. You can, once you click this dead node, it will show you the IP address of that particular machine. So that it will show you like which particular machine has went down. Okay. And also the name node storage. So the image edits and all those things were stored in this particular area. So, and it is active. In the sense, for every particular interval that was given in default, it is storing that also. So let me show you other things also. This is how my job tracker looks like. So my job tracker is connecting to the port 50030, right? So it is again showing the cluster summary. So the number of nodes is one. If at all, if I am running any job, maybe I am running some MapReduce program, here it will show you like how many tasks, map tasks were running and how many reduce tasks were running. Okay, there are few other things like mostly you won't see these things, but let me explain you also. Blacklisted nodes. So it will tell you like, for example, admin will consider like don't use this node at all, and we are not going to use maybe node 98 in my cluster. So it will be mentioned in my blacklisted nodes. For if it says like 2 or number 2 or something, it will show you like 2 machine IP addresses that were not being used in my cluster. You are not able to see all these things because you are running in a pseudo distributed mode. We have only one single machine and one single IP address, and definitely that should work, right? So anytime it will have a value of 0 only. So here it will show you number of jobs that were running, any retired jobs, all those information. So this is how the active task trackers. As the task tracker is also up, it is showing the there is a one single active task tracker and it is connecting to 4050. 40530 port. And the default values that I had given is 2 and 2. The default map tasks that I can run in my task tracker is 2. And the default reduced task that I can run in my task tracker is 2. So all these things are like again configurable. I can view as per my wish. So this is how my task tracker. So task tracker is connecting to 50060 port, right? So it will show you like how many tasks are running, if at all if any job is failed, it will show you in the logs. So you can see all the reports here. Okay. Let me show you the configuration directories also. So here I have listed whatever that were available in my configuration directory. So few important things is, the first one is coreside.xml, right? It is highlighted in green. We will see what I am having in my coreside.xml. See, I am just printing the value what I am having in my coreside. So if you see here, I had given one property, not one, basically two properties. So all the two properties were given under a single configuration sites. Okay, even though I have 10 properties, I will include all these properties into a single one configuration tag only. So the first property I had given is hadoop.temp.directory, and the value I had given is all the whatever the values that were temporary values that were generated, I will store into this directory. And the next one is fs.default.name. So this is how the name node I will connect, right? So when we had seen the local web interface, you will see, you are seeing this one only, right? The name node is connected to localhost 54310. So that's what it is mentioning. So if at all if I give any other port, it will connect maybe 8020. That is a default port that we will be using in our distributed environments for connecting to name node. So if I give here localhost colon 8020, I would be connecting to the name node, stating as it's connected to that particular port. Okay. Let's see the next one. Get dot XML. So here I'm having only one single property. That is the replication factor. I had declared the replication factor as 1. So that is the reason there is no much more replication in my pseudo distributed mode. If at all I go for a original distributed mode, I would give a replication factor as 3. And if I feel like my cluster is very big and definitely it's a very busy cluster, I may go for a replication factor of 5 also. So it's all my wish how I need to give it. And the next one is site.xml. So in my mapreduce.xml, I had given one configuration where my mapreduce jobs should connect to. So if at all I have to see my mapreduce.job.tracker in my web interface, it will be connected to localhost.54311 to run any of the map jobs or reduce jobs. So and the last one is get environment.sh. So this is an environment file, right? So okay. Here, see, I had given my Java path as export Java home. This is where actually I had installed my Java. User lib JVM Java 6 Oracle. So once I install Java, I have to note it here like this is where my Java location is. And also I had declared my heap size as 2000. So this is what the default value I had given here. If I don't declare anything, it will go for some other value, which is a default value that would be coming with Hadoop installations only. Hmm. Okay, this is another thing which you can see. One second, guys. Okay, if at all I give some path to my masters and slaves also, I can give it here. Maybe let me show you one thing here. So here, as I am having everything on a single node, it is just showing as local host only. So because there is only one master and the machine itself is this machine only, so it's just showing you as local host. But if you go to distributed mode, it will show you the IP address of my master machine. And the similar way for slaves as well. My single machine is a master as well as a slave. So that's the reason it's showing you as a local host only. But if it goes to distributed mode, I will see all the 97 machines if my cluster size is 100. So all the IP addresses you can see here when I give the command cat slaves. So that's what you can know about. That would be enough as per my knowledge. And all the remaining sites.xml, generally you will never ever touch those sites. These are the only few sites that you will be looking into or you will be playing with whenever you are installing Hadoop. That's what pretty much, guys, today. So tomorrow I will let you know like how, what are the different ways to interact with HDFS. Today I had shown you one web interface, right? There are few other ways also that I can interact with HDFS. So first of all, tomorrow I will finish the installation process. I will explain you, and I will also share the document so that you can follow the document. But be careful before going or before having any of the step in the document, because if anything goes down, even I'm not an admin guy and most of the times you have to browse your internets to set it again. Okay, so that's the reason I am giving you a note before itself. So just follow the instructions carefully so that you can have it installed nicely. And I'm telling you guys in front that installation of Hadoop is not a easy task. Definitely it will take a lot of time, but there is no other go. So that's what pretty much I have for today, guys. Any questions? So fine, guys. Thank you all for joining today's. Okay, Rahul have a question. You mentioned data nodes are usually installed in CentOS. Rahul, it's up to us, like in which operating system we want to install Hadoop. I can very well use Ubuntu, or I can go for CentOS. It's up to me, like which operating system I want to install Hadoop. For now, I'm following Ubuntu. So for the whole remaining classes, I will show you all the commands or whatever the programs I'm going to run on Ubuntu only. There is nothing different that you will feel. Your instructions will be only for Ubuntu. Yes, but in general, all the instructions will be same in any of the operating system. Maybe one or two commands will change when you have a differentiation between CentOS and Ubuntu, but everything will be in common. Right, Krishna. So once the installation is finished, you recommend VM or on actual Linux? I would recommend VM, Rahul, because most of us, we will be having a Windows as an operating system, right? That is the default operating system we would be getting. So my suggestion would be like download a VMware and install on top of it Ubuntu. And one of the advantages, like I can install a number of operating systems on my VMware, right? I can have Ubuntu or I can have CentOS as well at the same time. So whatever the operating system I want to connect, I can just switch over. So that's the reason I am asking you to download a VMware. Tomorrow I will let you know like what is the VMware that you have to download and what is the Hadoop version that you have to download and all those things. Arjun, for yesterday's and today's class, I mean, it's all under a single PPT, so that's the reason I haven't shared the yesterday's PPT. So once this finished, I will share you that one as well. And all the remainings, I think, hopefully you should have got it by now. Oh, okay. I will check with Vamsi, okay? I have shared those PPTs with him. Okay guys. I will talk with him, okay? I have shared the remaining PPTs, whatever we had discussed in the initial classes, like the Big Data Introduction, HDFS, Reads and Writes, all those PPTs I had shared with them. So probably they can give you a link so that you can have a look on it. But the cluster settings and all those things have everything on a single PPT. So probably by tomorrow I will share it. Okay? So okay guys, any other questions or shall we roll up for today? Fine guys, thank you all for joining. Let's meet tomorrow. Yes Krishna, once the HDFS, what I will do is, I will share the recordings topics wise. Okay, so once HDFS is finished, I will show you all the related recordings of HDFS. And again, once MapReduce is finished, I will share all the recordings of MapReduce. So this is how I share the recordings. Fine? Okay. Thank you, Krishna. So, any other questions? Okay, guys. Thank you for joining. Let's meet tomorrow at the same time, okay? Have a good night.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.